Yeah, I'm just stepping out for a minute. I'll join.
Cheers.
I'm back.
Okay, thank you. So I think we can get started now. Good evening all. So welcome to the last lecture of day one of the STEMS qualifier camp. So before we move on to the lecture, a very hearty congratulations to all of you for having made it through the first round of the STEMS exam. So we hope that these lectures really give you the enough motivation for your future endeavor in mathematical sciences. So today I'm honored to introduce Professor Manindra Agarwal of IIT Kanpur. So he's a professor at the Department of Computer Science and Engineering and the Deputy Director at IIT Kanpur. And he's best known for his work on the AKS primality test, which was the first unconditional deterministic algorithm to test a primality of a number in polynomial time of its number of digits. So we're honored to have the A in the AKS test, where the K and S are the last names of his two PhD students, Neeraj Kayal and Nitin Saxena. Professor Agarwal has numerous awards and accolades to his credit, a very few of which include the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prize for Science and Technology in 2003, the Girdle Prize in 2006, the Falkhazan Prize also in 2006, the World Academy of Sciences, PWAS Prize in 2010, the Padma Shri in 2013. He was also the first awardee of the Infosys Mathematical Prize in 2003. Just a quick request. So it would be nice if you could turn your videos on so that we can come closer to having a live lecture. So today, Professor Agarwal will attempt to take us through what the whole world is eagerly on the hunt for, which is a good model to predict the spread of a pandemic and hopefully give us some good news about when the pandemic will come to an end. So without further ado, so over to you, Professor Manindra. I hope all of you enjoy.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Aniruddhan. It's a real pleasure to be here virtually in front of all of you. As I was telling him, it's the most pleasurable part of an academic life is to interact with young minds, because they are the ones that give you fresh ideas, fresh energy, and really keep the motivation high. So I am going to today talk about the COVID Sutra, which Sutra is a new model for predicting the spread of COVID. And not just COVID, it could be used for other pandemics as well. I'll take you through the discovery, a little bit of discovery process of this, and also what the predictions that come out of this model. But before we do all of that, it's also the, if you take a step back, and it's very important to realize that it's a quite a remarkable application of mathematics. I mean, there is a set of differential equations that I'm going to show you. They model the spread of pandemic so well that it almost appears that these viruses know of this differential equation and they follow that trajectory. So it's a quite a wonderful application of very simple mathematical ideas to tell us something which is quite useful and important in real life. Although there is this famous saying that no good mathematics is useful, there are exceptions to that saying, and this certainly happens to be one of them. So let me start with the presentation. The COVID Sutra. The whole story about modeling of pandemics started about 100 years ago when the Spanish flu hit Europe and other countries of the world. And since by that time, people had started recording data and following trajectories of these pandemics reasonably well. So here is a plot of number of deaths through Spanish flu in UK. On the horizontal line are the dates and the year, and then the vertical line is the number of deaths per 1,000 persons. So you see, sometime towards end of September 1918, this graph started rising very rapidly, and peaked around beginning November, and by the end of December, it had subsided quite significantly. Of course, there was later on a slightly smaller peak again. But what is interesting to note is that this very sharp rise and fall of the deaths. And this led many to ask the question that how do we explain this? And eventually this was explained by two mathematicians, Carmack and McKendrick, in 1927. They proposed the first mathematical model for a pandemic, and it was named SIR model. And the reason that for this name was that they divided the entire population, which is under the influence of a pandemic, into three distinct groups. The group of susceptible people, those who are not yet infected, but may get infected. Second is those group of infected people. This is those who are already infected and presently stay infected. And third is a group of removed people. That is those who were infected in the past, but are no longer infected. They may even be dead. But it's really a combination of those who have recovered or those who have died. So this three category of population, the first letters of these three categories, S, I, R, were taken to give the name to this model. And it's easy to see that the transition from these three categories is from susceptible to infected and from infected to remote. Once we set this up, the next question is, how do we model the transition from one category to another? Well, clearly the population in these three categories will vary with time. So let's let S of T, I of T, and R of T represent the fraction of population in each of these three groups at some time T. Since these are fractions, it's clear that S plus I plus R is 1 always. Now, regarding transition from susceptible to infected, if you just do a thought experiment, it's clear that the number of people who get infected on a given day is going to be proportional to the size of susceptible population. The larger that size is, more people may get infected. It's also proportional to the infected population, because the more infected people are, they'll infect many more. So essentially, the change in the S category, which is captured by ds by dt, is proportional to S as well as I. So it's some constant times, which is, I'm calling beta here, beta times S times I. And there is a negative sign here because the susceptible population always decreases, because those who get infected move out of susceptible population. So this is the first, or rather the second equation, which models the transition from S category to the I category. Now from I to R, again, a bit of a thought experiment makes one realize that the larger the infected population is, the more people will get removed. So dr by dt, which represents the change in the removed population, that is proportional to I, and it's, there is a constant of proportionality gamma here. Once we have these two equations, the third equation writes itself, which is change in the infected population. This is a category which has both incoming people and outgoing people. So beta si come in from susceptible, gamma I go out to removed. So di by dt is beta si minus gamma I. And that's it. We have these three differential equations governing the spread of the pandemic over time. And quite remarkably, let's see if I have that. No. What, okay, before I show that, let's go to the another a subcategory of removed, which is the fatalities, which I am writing as D of T, the number of deaths at time, up to time T. So the change in the deaths, that is number of deaths on a given day, again is going to be proportional to the number of infected people. So it is equal to eta times I, where eta is another constant of proportionality. So these are the three unknown parameters, beta, gamma, and eta. Their values determine the trajectory of the pandemic. Now, what the SIR model was able to show, that for an appropriate choice of these three parameters, that sharp rise and fall that I showed you in the first plot is very nicely captured by these solutions of these three differential equations. So that's the first success, and that's where the whole domain of mathematical modeling of pandemics started. By the way, we certainly, it was not true then, but it is true now, that we have seen this example in COVID case also, that we do have fairly good time series data for new infections every day, the new recoveries every day, and new deaths every day. So these three are the data, and there is a very large time series over many, many months is available for us, through which we can hope to estimate the parameter values, but only for SIR model. And as we will see, this is not a very useful or correct model for COVID. In fact, this is not, SIR is not useful for several other pandemics also, but the SIR introduced something quite interesting, which is the time when the pandemic peaks. So there is this plot which you saw going up. At what location is it at the maximum? Well, that was a time peak for the pandemic will peak when the number of infected peaks. And at the peak, di by dt is zero. That's a simple calculus. So di by dt was beta si minus gamma I. So this becomes zero. And therefore, s is gamma over beta. So when the susceptible fraction of population is equal to gamma over beta, that is the point at which the pandemic peaks. And this value, in fact, gamma over beta is also given a name, 1 over R0, or R0 is beta over gamma. And R0 is a well-known variable which is talked about even these days with respect to COVID. What is clear is that the value of R0 is less than equal to 1, then S, that is at S at the peak, is greater than equal to 1, which means right at the beginning of pandemic, when S is 1, the peak has already been passed, which means that the pandemic will continuously die out. It will never actually spread. It will just keep on shrinking. So therefore, R0 happens to be a very crucial parameter associated with pandemic. And its value, the larger value of R0 is, the longer it will take for pandemic to peak. Okay, as I was saying, that not all pandemics follow SIR model. For example, measles has the property that an infected person, after getting infected, doesn't immediately start infecting others. There is a gestation period during which the person has infection inside, but it is not getting passed to the others. And this special property was captured by modifying SIR model to SEIR model by bringing in this additional category called exposed. So from susceptible, you move to exposed. Exposed, you move to infected, infected to removed. And exposed are precisely those who are infected but are in the gestation period. And we can write down the differential equations for this as well. Now that we have four categories, so the sum of these four quantities is one. ds by dt is again minus beta times s times I. E plays no role in infecting others. Now beta si move to exposed. So dE by dt is beta si, and then some alpha fraction move to infected, and di by dt is therefore alpha e comes in and gamma I move to removed, and dr by dt is gamma I. So that's straightforward, just one more differential equation. In fact, if you add in e and I and rewrite the equation for I plus e, you just get SIR model. So this has this nice property. This is actually a proper refinement of SIR. Now, some other these pandemics, and COVID-19 happens to be one of them, have this additional or special property that an infected person can be of two types, symptomatic and asymptomatic. A symptomatic person will know that, okay, this person is exhibiting symptoms, so this person is infected. But an asymptomatic person, may not himself or herself know about the infection. And yet, that asymptomatic person can continue to spread infections to others. So it is different from the exposed category of SEIR model. Here, the asymptomatic infected person does pass on the infection to others. So therefore, the model changes. And this has been captured in another variation called SAIR model, where a susceptible person moves to first being asymptomatic. An asymptomatic person can become symptomatic after a few days. So that is represented by this infected category. On the other hand, an asymptomatic person can remain asymptomatic throughout the infection period and then moves to the removed category. Or in similarly, infected person can, after some period, move to the removed category. So the transitions here are different from SEIR model. And again, differential equations for this can be written down. Now that you see the five blocks are there, although the two removed categories are essentially captured the same, but one is removed from asymptomatic and one is removed from infected. So we represent them by different symbol R sub A and R sub I. The sum of these five quantities is one. Now ds by dt is now you see proportional to minus beta times s is equal to minus beta times s times a plus I. Now here a plus I represents the total number of infected people and they can pass on the infection to others. Now all of them become asymptomatic. So dA by dt is beta S times A plus I. Gamma A of them move to removed category, and we now introduce this new term, delta A of them move to infected. So they start exhibiting symptoms. dI by dt is delta A comes in, gamma I goes out, and the rest remains the same. Again, if you add in A and I and RA and RI, you get back the SIR model. So again, a proper refinement of SIR model. And this set of differential equation govern this asymptomatic type of pandemic. And indeed, this was used to model COVID-19. But this set of equations have a problem, which is that it's very hard to estimate these parameter values from the data. Particularly the parameter delta is really a tough nut to crack. Remember, the delta is a parameter which says that delta times A move from asymptomatic to symptomatic. Now, COVID-19 particularly has this property that it has a very large number of asymptomatic cases. In fact, people estimate, and as I'll show you later on, nearly everyone who is infected is asymptomatic. Only a very small fraction are symptomatic. So the question is that how does one even estimate the large number of asymptomatic cases, because there is really no clear, I mean, you only get to see the symptomatic cases. Also, we get also to represent, to capture some asymptomatic cases, because through contact tracing, for example, many asymptomatic infected cases also get tested positive and then they get recorded. So, like I just mentioned, the SAIR model is not, and it does capture the dynamics reasonably well, but it's a hard nut to crack. And that gives rise to the desire for having a different model than SAIR, which can capture the dynamics of COVID-19 and also has easier analysis. And fortunately, we can do both. That's what leads to the Sutra model. So here, the general diagram, the transition diagram is the same as SAIR, but the meaning is slightly different. First of all, we say susceptible goes to undetected. Of course, that's very obviously true that the moment the person becomes infected won't know that he or she is infected. So from susceptible, you go to undetected category of infection. Some of them test positive and they move to the T category. The rest of them remain undetected and move to the removed category. And from tested positive also, after some time, they move to the removed category. So now we have the four broad groups are susceptible, undetected, tested positive, and removed. So SUTR is the name for the model. If you follow the earlier methodology, we just added A at the end to add the approach so that we can call it Sutra. Okay, so how about the dynamics of this? Well, you might think that I have just changed the name, so the dynamics should more or less stay the same as SAIR, and that is would be correct. But since SAIR model dynamics is hard to estimate, what we worked on was to improve the dynamics, which simultaneously becomes easier to estimate. The sum of these five quantities is one. ds by dt is, if you see the slightly change, minus is proportional to s times u. And that's because those who test positive, they get quarantined. So after testing positive, you don't get a chance to infect others. So the only persons who are infecting others are those in u, more or less. So that's why ds by dt is beta s. They for all move to the, yeah. Anyone?
But here, there should be some factor where like some percentage of the detected people also pass on the infection, because it's not exactly perfect that no one who tests positive.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Okay. So here is the thing. All these equations only approximate the reality. Because, as you very rightly said, some of the tested positive, they might not get into quarantine and then they will continue passing the infection to others. But the fraction of them is so small that we can, of course, add the term U plus a small fraction of T. But that's not going to make much difference in the dynamics of it, but it's going to complicate the equation unnecessarily. So the idea is to keep the equations as simple as possible, but fairly close to the reality. Okay. Now, du by dt, that is those who come into undetected, are beta su, of course. Then gamma u move to the removed category. And then this quantity, which I am calling x right now, get detected.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sir, these days some of the tested people are also being wrongly, means some of the people who are not having the virus also are being tested as positive. Like test results are being wrong at times. So
yes.
Can that be included in the model also?
It can be included, but the my point that I just made remains valid there. That yes, some of them are, it does happen that wrongly tested positive, but the fraction of those is minuscule compared to those who are correctly tested positive.
Yes.
And therefore, you know, taking care of this small minuscule fractions of, you know, due to and which lead to complication of the equation is not advisable, because then you can't really model the dynamics well.
Yeah.
Okay.
So
that is a factor that always have to be kept in mind, that these equations are an side of an idealization of reality. So there is always some amount of error which is in real world, which is not there here.
Sir,
yeah.
In the DSTT equal to minus beta SU, are we considering the susceptible transition into the undetected?
That's correct. That's correct. All susceptible after getting infection transition to undetected.
All right. So it doesn't directly transition into infected.
They transition to infected, but undetected infection.
Okay.
Not tested positive.
Okay. Thank you.
Now, X of U transition to positive and at any time. And that's what comes in into the tested positive category, and gamma T goes to the removed category. So the rest is same. And again, adding UNT and RU and RT reduces essentially to SIR model. So again, a refinement of SIR model. The key thing is this quantity X. In SAIR model, X was delta U. I mean, if we follow SAIR model logic, it should be delta U. But it's a bad choice for two reasons. One, that delta is hard to estimate, so that's one. This is a practical problem. But there is another problem with this. Let's just think the way testing strategies are being employed in COVID, which is primarily through contact tracing, and who are the people among undetected category who will get tested positive. So the way contact tracing work is that somebody develops a symptom, so gets tested and found positive. Then everybody who this person has come in contact in past few days is also traced and tested. And then if you want to go one more layer, so whoever are tested positive among this set of people, everybody who they came in touch with in the last past few days, they are again tested and so on. Now the thing is that the original person who was tested positive, generally, you know, after infection within a week, people develop symptoms. So we'll get tested positive within a week of getting infected. And everybody through contact tracing of that person who gets tested positive will have gotten infection from this person, and therefore would have gotten infection only in past few days, certainly less than 7 days. So the set of through contact tracing, the set of people who get tested positive is biased towards recent infections, not the sum total of all infections. And therefore, modeling it as a constant fraction of U is not as good a choice as our idea of modeling it as a constant fraction of recently infected. So now beta SU is the number of infected people today on at time t. So let's say if we are talking about today, beta SU is infected today. And the number of infections don't change very dramatically over a few days. So some constant times beta SU is the capture the size of or the those number of those people who got infected in past few days. Well, k is that number, whatever number of days is. And in a delta fraction of this number is what gets tested positive. So we set X to delta times k times beta su, and delta k we are just replaced by this constant epsilon. So it's a x, therefore it's epsilon beta su instead of delta u. And this improvement, so to speak, in the estimation of transition from u to t also makes the analysis very, very nice, which I'll just show you in a moment. So just compare now the equations for u and t. So du by dt plus gamma u is now beta times 1 minus epsilon times su. And dt by dt plus gamma t is beta times epsilon times su. Just rewrite this, or rather combine these to write, we can deduce this very easily. D by dt of t minus epsilon prime u is equal to minus gamma times t minus epsilon prime u, where epsilon prime is just this number epsilon over 1 minus epsilon. And this differential equation is a very classical one, easily solvable. We get from this that t is epsilon prime u plus e to the minus gamma t, which tells us that there is this exponential decay in the additive term. So very quickly, t converges to epsilon times u, which is quite a remarkable deduction, because then we have this very nice relationship between t and u. Not only that, we get roughly the same relationship between rt and ru, which is rt is very quickly converges to epsilon prime times ru plus a constant c. So therefore, we can eliminate two of the quantities essentially because of this direct relationship between the two of them. Now, this lends this model to much nicer analysis. There are now, unlike the SIR model, this has now six parameters, five of which I have already introduced. Beta is the rate at which people get infected, gamma is the rate at which people recover or die, eta is the rate at which infected people die. Epsilon is this, so as we just deduced, is a ratio of detected to total infection. C is that constant that connects RT to RU. And finally, there is another parameter rho, which I haven't introduced, but which will start coming in shortly. This is the fraction of population outside bubbles. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, all of you have heard of this bubble formation. The Indian team is inside a bubble these days, and in IPL, people were inside a bubble everywhere. People are doing the following, that to protect themselves or a group of people from COVID, they ensure that a group of people only interact among themselves. They don't interact to the outside world. And that is what is called formation of a bubble. So clearly, the people who are inside a bubble cannot get infected unless the bubble bursts. Therefore, the effective population, remember that S, all of these quantities, S, R, U, T, they are fractions. They are fractions where the denominator is the total population of the region under consideration. But that total population needs to be replaced with the population outside the bubbles, because those inside the bubbles are not going to play any role. So rho is that parameter which captures that fraction of population outside the bubbles. And as, of course, this will also change with time. In fact, this will keep on monotonically increasing with time, because as time proceeds, more and more bubbles burst and people get infected even inside bubbles. Okay. So how do we estimate these six parameters? Well, here is the data that we have available. We have this time series, which I'm calling T hat. It is the total number of detected cases every day. This T hat is simply rho times P times capital T, T is a fraction, and rho times capital P is our effective population. P is the total population of the region. Similarly, R hat T, which is a recovery from those tested positive, that is rho P times R of T, and D hat of T is rho P of T. Now, using these three time series, firstly, these two time series, we can write the equation D R hat by DT equals gamma T hat, and DD by DT is eta times T hat by just clearing the denominators. And since we know this time series, this one, and this one, the value of gamma and eta can be very easily estimated. You actually get a lot more equations than the unknowns. So using the standard least square method or approximating the unknown, one can calculate the values of these two parameters. So these two are very easy to do. What about the rest four? Well, here is the key governing equation that can be derived from the analysis that I just showed you for the COVID. It is T hat equals this quantity. This is somewhat complicated looking expression. It has these two constant multipliers, 1 over beta times 1 minus C and 1 over epsilon rho times 1 minus C. Using this, again using the time series which is known, one can estimate the value of beta times 1 minus C and epsilon rho times 1 minus C. So you get two more numbers. Now extracting from them the individual values of these four parameters requires a little more work, which is more complex, but it can be done. The only thing therefore then required is the initial value of epsilon. That's that is the starting point when we start the modeling of the dynamics. At that time, exactly how many people were infected? That's a data that no model can tell us. So we just have to assume some number there. And that's what is required to be chosen appropriately. Once we have that, the rest can be estimated. Another complication here is that these parameters values change with time. You know, eta, for example, changes with improvement in healthcare. Eta earlier was high for COVID, now it's much lower. Beta changes significantly because of lockdowns or people following personal safety protocols. Epsilon, which is the ratio between detected and total infections, well, depending on the testing strategy, the value of epsilon will change. And of course, rho keeps on increasing because as the bubbles burst, this infection spreads to different parts, the rho keeps on increasing. So essentially, all the parameters change with time. Now, in order to model that, instead of assuming that them as a function of time, because they change with time rather slowly, we split the time period into phases. And for each phase, we assume these parameters to be constant. So these all the parameters are therefore taken to be piecewise constant. So that's how the entire modeling gets set up for the Sutra model. Now let me show you some results using that. First of all, for India. In India, the lockdown started on 25th of March, and that's the time from when we started the simulation. We have found broadly six phases until 31st of December. First phase from 25th March to 3rd of May, that is a period of the most strict lockdown. Second from 4th May to 20th June. Third from 20th June to 21st August. Then 22nd August to 27th September and so on. So essentially, April, May and part of June, then the rest of June, then July and August. Then this next phase 4 is September, phase 5 is October. And phase 6 is November and December. Here are the estimated values of beta and other parameters. Beta, if you see, started with 0.14, went down to 0.1, and then started increasing 0.12, 0.14, 0.13, and in the last phase, currently is 0.18. gamma is the recovery, it keeps on improving the recovery rate. Similarly, eta is mortality rate, it keeps on reducing essentially. 1/ε, the ratio between detected to total cases, this is the initial guess that we made, 125, and I'll explain why this guess was made. And then it has reduced and has been essentially around 71, 72 since July. So it has kind of stabilized. This tells us that in India, for every detected case, there are about 70 plus undetected cases. Finally, rho, this is also instructive. This is in percentage, so not as a fraction. So in April, 0.6% population was under the influence of the pandemic. That means 99.4% percentage of population was under different kind of bubbles. You know, some bubble would, these bubbles were very natural because in some district, if infection has not even reached, and the because of the lockdown, the connection between districts is broken, there is a natural bubble that the entire district comes under. So essentially, this is telling us that nearly entire India was under a bubble and only a small fraction was outside. This fraction increased to about 9% in May and then climbed very fast to about 70+%. This is really towards the end of August. This is probably percentage August. And what happened in this intervening period to make it climb so fast? Well, look at the time period. This is when the migrant worker population from wherever they were, they went home. May, June was the main migrant period when they moved home. And they took the infection along with them to different parts of the country. In addition, from July, the lockdown conditions were relaxed substantially. And that also contributed to this spread. And since then, it has been increasing rather slowly. And actually, from October onwards, it has more or less been stable. Now, notice that in November, there was a massive increase in the interaction between people, as also evidenced by this increase in beta, because of the festival season, people were moving out. Not many were following safety protocols. And yet, the rho did not increase by any significant amount. So what this is telling us is that rho probably has already reached the saturation point, which is close to 100%. And that is why we chose this initial starting point to 125. Choosing this point changes this value. And once we have all of this, also from the model comes out the prediction that more than the 55% of the population currently has antibodies in it. This is the population of India. And here is the prediction for the India trajectory. The blue curve is the actual data plotted for the active infections, which are detected. And this orange curve is the model prediction. As you can see, it is following it extremely closely. And we are, 31st December is here, so this is where we are. Since then, it again is continuing to drop. There are some ICMR survey results which sort of match with our model predictions also. Okay. From the model also comes out this very interesting analysis that right in the beginning, early periods of the pandemic, how were things changing? If you see this orange curve and blue curve are kind of in tandem here, slight margin of error. What we did was we said, assume that suppose there was no lockdown done, what would have happened? That's represented by this red curve. And as you see, in April itself, numbers would have shot up very, very rapidly. This is very real exponential growth. And this is also starkly reflected by this data that between 18th to 31st March, this 14 days, the number of cases increased by a factor of 10. So even now here in the early days, the growth was exponential, although not as fast as without lockdown would have been. As so look at this data point. In between 1st April to 12th June, in these 73 days, the actual cases increased by a factor of 100. If there was no lockdown in the same period, the actual cases would have increased by a factor of more than 10,000. So that's the dramatic reduction that the lockdown achieved. This our analysis also looks at various possible scenarios in case there was no lockdown. The number of active cases would have peaked at more than 1.4 crores in June. Number of deaths would have been very large, 25 plus lakhs. We modeled delayed lockdown, which means that announce a lockdown, allow people to travel for a week or two to go to their back to their respective places, and then impose a lockdown, unlike the way it was done very suddenly. Then such cases also, number of active cases would have been much higher, number of deaths would have been much higher. So this initial very dramatic lockdown did save a large number of lives. Of course, it also, it had the downside of creating major difficulties to many people. But on the balance, if you look at it, it turns out, according to our model, that sudden lockdown was the right strategy. Okay, now since you guys are in Chennai, or at least you are representing CMI. So here is the plot for Chennai. Chennai had seen three distinct peaks, one major peak and then two short peaks, and today is coming down. And the orange curve, which is the prediction from the model, is following it reasonably closely, except here. And there is a reason why there is you see the deviation here, because when this peak had occurred, then the government was changing the strategies for lockdowns and other things quite rapidly. And the model can't really change its trajectories so rapidly. So that's where the slight deviation that you see has occurred here. As per our model, again, more than 50% of Chennai population has antibodies at present. And finally, I'll show you this plot for Italy. We have applied the model to many countries. The reason I'm showing you the Italy plot is because Italy has a very nice system, that is the medical setup, where their data reporting is extremely good. And the better data is, that is, the less errors are there in the data. And assuming that our model is correctly formulated when capturing the COVID dynamics, then the prediction curve should match very well with the actual curve. And that's what you see with Italy. You see the blue curve and orange curve really are one on top of the other. Although with Italy, at Italy, we estimate only about 15-16% of population has antibodies at the moment, because they have imposed very strict lockdowns for an extended period, which has not allowed the pandemic to spread. A lot of bubbles still exist there. So that's the COVID sutra in a nutshell. As I said, we have actually modeled all the states of India. We have also modeled many other countries. So in case you are interested, I can show you their plots as well.
Thank you very much, Professor Manindra. That was absolutely, it did open our eyes in quite some aspects on where we are heading towards. And we do really hope for a speedy decline of the numbers. So there are a couple of questions in the chat. So I'll maybe ask them out one by one.
Sure.
So how would the vaccinations be factored? Mm-hmm. Where will it come into play?
See, what vaccination would do is, here, if you go back to the picture, yeah. Vaccination will introduce a new transition from susceptible to remote directly. And so it can be easily modeled in into the system. We know the efficacy of vaccine as per reported data is like almost 90%. So the fraction of there is a whatever the number that gets vaccinated, 0.9 times of that will get removed, and that will be another way of reducing the susceptible population. So it would then can get captured into the equations quite easily and modeled.
Okay, thank you. And there's one more question relating to this. So how will you predict the occurrence of a second wave? So this is because like you've assumed something is declining, and a second wave, you're actually assuming that something is going to increase again. So what gives you a good tool to predict a second?
That's correct. Yeah, that's a good question. So here, look at the Italy. There was a first wave, and there is a much bigger second wave. And what we are saying, predicting is, let's say, of course, now that vaccine is there, so things will change. But in case there was no vaccine, there would have been a third wave also in Italy. Because right now, they have again imposed strict lockdown measures. And because of that, they are bringing this curve down. But when they relax those measures, because only 15% of the population is infected, the curve will rise again. As opposed to India. India, we don't think there will be a second wave at all. The reason being that more than 55% of population already has antibodies as per the model. And at that threshold, you remember I showed you for SIR model that R0, a similar exercise can be done for Sutra model also. And the estimates show that when the susceptible population fraction goes below 45%, then the pandemic starts declining, which has already happened. So we do not expect the curve to rise again. There will be, of course, local maximas. In some region where the infection is less, it will spread, the numbers will increase there. As you can see, some states sometimes show a rise, sometimes they come down. But if you look at cumulatively in India, the curve is not going to rise. Of course, this comes with a caveat. The caveat is that when we say people are immune because they have antibodies in them, it is not clear how long those antibodies last. Once those antibodies go away, then of course those persons from the removed category, they again become susceptible. When would that occur is not clear. Will it ever occur? It's also not clear because there is very little data so far about COVID antibodies lasting. It's been there only for about a year. So that is something that is unknown.
Okay, thank you, sir. That was a really interesting answer. So one follow-up question to this. How does the model predict the percentage of population with antibodies?
Okay. That's because we can simulate the complete dynamics of it. Let me go back to this. Yeah. T converges to epsilon times U. Okay. And T plus RT converges to this quantity. T T plus R sub T converges to epsilon times U plus, and this is actually always equal to U epsilon prime times U plus RU plus C. Now T plus R sub T is the total number of people who have been detected positive till date. It's a cumulative number, right? T is currently infected, R sub T are those who were infected in the past and have removed. Similarly, U plus RU is the total number of people who have been infected but in undetected category so far. Again, cumulative number. We know T plus R sub T. We know epsilon prime and we know C. Through the model, we can estimate these parameters. That allows us to compute U plus RU. Now, the total number of cumulatively infected people is U plus R sub U plus T plus R sub T. So we can estimate, therefore, the total number of cumulative infected people, and that allows us to estimate the percentage of people with antibodies.
Thank you. That was nice. Thank you. And okay, so two questions just regarding the percentage with antibodies again. I'll just read them out together. Mm-hmm. So the first is Italy has 15% of Italy's population, 15% of them have antibodies, while in India it's 55%.
Yep.
So where does this difference arise? That's the first question. And the second question, so will the second wave happen only depending on whether most of the population has antibodies or not? Does that play a ratio?
Okay, the second answer first. Indeed, that only depends on what fraction of population is in the removed category. Like I said, or rather, what fraction of population is in susceptible category. If less than 45% of population is in susceptible category, then the pandemic will not rise. That is, there will never be a peak. It will keep on declining. That's the answer to the second question. The first question, yeah, the difference between Italy and India. Well, that has been here. The last column, row. Italy, because of having imposed very strict lockdowns and for an extended period, and plus people, I mean, small groups of people forming bubbles in which they are still continue to stay, a large fraction of population hasn't even been touched by the pandemic, but they are remain susceptible. They are not susceptible today because they are inside the bubble, but whenever they come out of the bubble, they become possible for infection. In fact, this recent peak in Italy, the second peak, this was primarily driven by this expansion in Rho. Rho increased by almost a factor of 7. And that's what has caused this sharp rise. So the possibility still exists because the number of the fraction of population inside the bubble is so large that when they come out of the bubbles, well, the pandemic will spread there. In India, the bubbles don't almost, today, I don't think their bubbles exist. The reason for that is that if you look at this today, people move around without much of precautions. The markets are crowded. This was especially so during the festival season in November. And yet, there was no rise in the in the number of infected people. There was a slight uptick, of course. India had this small, you see that there. This was a small peak which was due to this November, but it's such a tiny peak which really shows that we have effectively covered all the entire population, and there are almost nobody inside the bubble today. And that's what gives us confidence that we will not see another peak in India.
Okay. So, and regarding the, even like the one that you recently mentioned, so even though there are many people going outside and mingling with others, so would you attribute the small increase to something like herd immunity, or
that's what the herd immunity is. The herd immunity is that value of R naught, that is the when S becomes small enough, and in this case less than 45%, you reach the herd immunity stage. That means the infection simply doesn't spread, because you know there are more people who are immune than the people who are not immune. So the possibility of one person infecting another reduces significantly.
Okay, thank you. And so a couple of what are some of the assumptions which you think may not hold in the model? One, and what plans can we expect to enhance the model, or what further work can be done on the model?
So the assumptions that the first assumption that the most important assumption is that the model correctly captures the COVID dynamics. That is simply a hypothesis. It can never be proven to be correct. What we can do is compare the predictions of the model with actual reality and see, convince ourselves that yes, it seems to be fitting in. And I've shown you some examples of that. So that assumption always exists. There is the second assumption that we assume that the model correctly captures the dynamics, we can extract all the parameter values directly from the data. The only other assumption we make is the starting value of 1 over epsilon, which we have here, for example, for India, assumed to be 125. These are some indications of why this may be the correct value. One reasoning I have already given, that is the rho is not increasing. And despite people moving freely, that would only happen if rho was anywhere close to the maximum possible. There is another indicator to that. ICMR conducted a nationwide survey in the month of May, in which they estimated about about 7 crore people to be infected. No, is it 7 crores? No, 70 lakh people to be infected in the first half of May. And if you assume the initial 1 over epsilon to 125, and you run the model that we have, then in the first half of May, the model also crosses 70 lakh infections. So that's another data point which suggests that this choice of 1 over epsilon is reasonable. It may not be exact. I don't think you can ever get the exact. Whether it is 125, 120, 130, I think it's very hard to really say, but it's a rough approximation. And so these are the, this is the only point of assumption in the model, and this one has to be a little careful in selecting. Like, for example, I chose a particular value for initial value because of a sero survey done in Italy in the month of, I believe it was April, or yeah, there was some period during which the survey was done. And the results of those sero surveys, I chose that parameter value to match with the results of that sero survey. Because sero surveys are the ones that can give you an estimate of total number of infections, as opposed to only detected ones. So I aligned the initial value to match with that sero survey, and then you get the rest.
Okay, thank you. Maybe a couple of concluding questions. So one of them is the timing of the lockdown. So is that the apt, or is there a better? So that was one question. Mm-hmm. Is there some other time where we could have shuffled the lockdown around or what impact would it have had? And the second question, maybe the final one, will be the regarding the new strain of COVID. Mm-hmm. So what impact is can the model predict for that to have?
Yeah. So regarding lockdown, it's impossible to say right now what would have been the most optimal date of the lockdown. However, what we can conclude are the following. Number one, it was better that the way lockdown was imposed suddenly, like you give like 4 hours and then just shut everything down, as opposed to if you allow people 1 week and then shut things down. Because what would happen in that 1 week, people will rush back to their native places and therefore carry infection with them to places where infection never even exists at that point. So that would have spread, caused this row, for example, which increased only slowly 0.6 to 9% during May, June. And then you see it ramped up to 72% in next couple of months. That would have happened much earlier, this ramping up. And if it had it happened much earlier, there was really very, it would have been very difficult to manage the situation, because the COVID, we did not have PPE kits, the hospitals were not equipped to handle COVID patients. The doctors did not know what is the correct treatment protocol for COVID patients. So it would have been a complete chaos. So therefore, we can conclude that sudden lockdown was better. Now, next question is when? What was the right date on which to impose a lockdown? One can say that the earlier, the better it is, because the earlier you impose a lockdown, the better, you know, the less spread that you see. Now, whether 25th of March was the right date, or whether 20th March would have been the right date, 15th March would have been the right date, we can debate all of that. Our model can't really do much, because the data, early March data, is so, the numbers are so small that, you know, basing predictions on those is very error prone. So I would not like to really use or rely on those predictions. Also, there is another fact. It turns out that very strict lockdowns are counterproductive. In India, apart from that first lockdown in April, remaining lockdowns have been fairly leaky. That is, there were lockdown, but people were quietly moving here and there, everywhere, slowly. And the migrants moved and other people moved. What they did was they slowly took the infection to all parts of the country, and or maybe other regions also. Within a city, there were some parts which were not infected together. So that slowly made the population immune over an extended period of time. And that, in hindsight, is the best possible strategy. I don't think it was intended at all. It is just that our system is porous, so things happen in a somewhat leaky way. And that turned out to be the right strategy for this one, because now, because of the leaky lockdowns, the infection has spread everywhere. The row has increased to nearly full value. Unlike many Western countries where the row is still small, so they are again, they have to struggle with keeping things under control. In fact, the most remarkable story here is that of Taiwan and South Korea. There, the row, our estimates say that the value of row even today is less than 1%. That is, more than 99% of their population is still under a bubble, or these multiple bubbles, keeping them strictly separate, segregated from the infected side. So they really need the vaccine, because if they relax, they'll get in a difficult situation. And regarding this new strain, I really don't think it will do much damage to India, because what new strain does is, because it spreads faster, so the value of beta will increase. from 0.18, it's supposed to spread about 70% faster. But the old strain is also there. So it might go up to 0.22, 0.23. And that's not going to cause much of a dent into the progression of the pandemic in the country.
Okay, thank you very much. So we really do hope that things do get better as soon as possible and we get back to campuses, our respective campuses, as soon as we can. So once again, thank you very much, Professor Manindra, for delivering this wonderful lecture and in fact, opening our eyes on what we can expect to see in the near future. Thank you very much once again for that. Just a couple of, so tomorrow, so this concludes day one of the qualifier STEMS camp. So tomorrow we'll meet again at 11 o'clock to Professor Sujay Ashok's talk. He's a professor at IMSC. And at 14,
can you share the PPT of all the sirs today who have presented?
I think that we can get back to you a bit later.
Yeah, okay. No,
thank you. And tomorrow at 2:30 p.m., we have Professor Xavier Vianot of CNRS, who will be talking about bijective combinatorics. Oh, I forgot to mention. So Professor Sujay Ashok will be talking on the principle of least action, which is very much based on the well-renowned Feynman. So, and finally, the third lecture of tomorrow will be by Professor Srikant Srinivasan of IIT Bombay, who will be talking on polynomials, combinatorics, and computation. So I hope all of you enjoyed your day one. And once again, thank you very much, Professor Manindra, for delivering this lecture. Thank you. We now come to a close. Thank you.